Hello and welcome to all of Joe's family. And I'm glad some of you have already been here before, so you know your way around. Some of you at least know where the bathroom facilities are, so that's good. This is our church home, and today I can say to every one of you, it's your church home too today. And so a big welcome. And kids are important, so we're just waiting for one of the young girls to come upstairs. So, but a big welcome to everyone. Oh, and again, welcome, especially to the youngest members of your family. Let us begin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In the waters of baptism, Joe died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. At this time, members of the family will help unfold this white cloth. This white cloth is another reminder of Joe's baptism. Just as a baby usually wears white, so we have this white cloth. And it's because Joe has been joined to Christ, especially, you know, in baptism, that he shares in both Christ's death and in his resurrection. And we have this crucifix, which we know is a symbol of Joe's faith and our faith in Jesus. It's a beautiful symbol to show us God's love for us in Jesus. At this time, we will be making our procession into church, and every procession, if you will, is a symbol of our journey through life, our journey which will take us to the Father in heaven. And so we make this journey one more time with Joe.
Mercies without end, we
you would, you may please stand. Let us pray. O God, almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant Joe, who has fallen asleep in Christ, may rejoice to rise again through him who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, if you would, you may please be seated. And we are inviting Samantha, Eva's daughter, Joe's granddaughter, to come up to proclaim the first reading.
A reading from the book of the prophet of Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples. The web that is woven over all nations, he will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces. The reproach of his people, he will remove from the whole earth. For the Lord has spoken. On that day, it will be said, behold our God, to whom we looked to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us. The word of the Lord.
Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. God is my shepherd, so nothing shall I want. I rest in the meadows of faithfulness and love. I walk by the quiet waters of peace.
Shepherd me beyond my wants, beyond my from death to life.
Gently you raise me and heal my weary soul. You lead me by pathways of righteousness and truth. My spirit shall sing the music of your name.
Though I should wander the valley of death, I fear no evil, for you are at my side. Your rod and your staff, my comfort and my hope.
Crowning me with
Surely your kindness and mercy follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of my God forevermore.
This time we invite Lelaine, Eva's daughter-in-law, Joe's granddaughter-in-law, to come up to proclaim the second reading.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, see what love the Father has bestowed on us, that we may be called the children of God. Yet, so we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. We do know that when it is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me will never die. Glory and praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again to take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. If you would, you may please be seated. From our heart, we give all of you our sympathies
from our local church community, as well as from Joe's parish in Sanford. Those sympathies, especially to Joe's daughter, Eva, and to your husband, William, and to all your family, including Joe's grandchildren, to Samantha and your husband, John, and your children, Jude and Griffin, Joe's great-grandsons, to Robert and your partner, Carly, to Marcus and your wife, Lelaine, and your precious daughter, Audrey, Joe's great-granddaughter, to Joe's nieces and nephews, Kathy, Mary Angela, Andrea, Janice, Marilyn, David, and Albert, and also to those who knew Joe through his church here and in Sanford, his friends at Lee County Enrichment Center, and those who provided his health care, and to all of Joe's friends and relatives, those present and those not present. We need many sources of strength, especially in times of stress or sadness. One source of strength is, of course, in the people we are connected to. Not only those we see here, but all those who we have a connection to in life. Sometimes we are tired. Sometimes we're tired of hurting and maybe even tired of being tired. When we know we are in a safe place, we have the strength to make progress through these feelings. Some of these emotions are important ones. The feelings associated with the loss of our loved one reminds us, for example, of our need to receive love and to love and serve others. And connected to the strength we receive from those around us, we also find strength in our memories and in the stories we share of Joe. We will hear some of those in the words that Eva and Marcus will be sharing later. We turn to those memories for strength, and we also find opportunity to share those stories with each other. These are some of the sources of our strength. There is an even greater source of strength, and that is our faith in God. Our scriptures today remind us of this source of strength and hope. Samantha proclaimed the first reading from the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah tells us that God will provide for all peoples. God promises to take care of us, and that is what true hope is based on. Specifically, the prophet Isaiah tells us God will destroy death forever and will wipe away the tears from all faces. The prophet Isaiah announces this and many promises guaranteed by God. Those promises are reflected in the responsorial psalm. The author of Psalm 23 trusts God and therefore asks God to be our shepherd. Above all, our shepherd gives us the strength so that we can find peace. Lelaine proclaimed the second reading from the first letter of St. John, and in it we hear about the power of God's love. Because of God's love, we are children. We are God's children now. That love is a powerful bond which links us to God. We experience that love even now while we are on earth. When we eventually get to heaven, we will be like God and will truly see Him. These promises of God, again, give us true hope. And in the gospel, we hear of another powerful promise. Jesus tells us, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. I will go to prepare a place for you, and I'll come back again to take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. I am the way and the truth and the life." We can trust in the promises of Jesus. It is by looking to him, listening to him, and following him that we will always have the true source of hope and peace. Since our greatest source of strength is in God, the most important thing we can do today is to pray. No matter how good we are at praying, just having that time, setting some time for God, lets us be open to his healing and love. And then when we pray, we have an opportunity to express the things that are important to us. Somebody sang a song about say what you need to say, and I think that applies to our relationship with Jesus more than anything else. We need to tell Jesus what's important to us. Our central prayer today is that Jesus receives Joe into everlasting life of joy and give us the strength we need. These prayers also help to strengthen the spiritual connection that we have to Joe. The Second Vatican Council taught us that our spiritual connection continues to grow after death. As we pray for Joe, our prayers connect us to him in a special way. In return, those who have passed before us in God's friendship continue to think of us who remain here. In fact, as our loved ones enter into the intimate presence of Jesus in heaven, their prayers will be even more powerful. And so Joe will continue to be connected to us, and in that spiritual way will continue to grow. During this time of prayer, during our celebration of this Eucharist, this funeral mass, let us entrust our prayers and our whole selves into God's love and mercy, and we will always have the strength we need today and every day of our lives.
assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our brother Joe. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. Lord, in your mercy, pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If you would, you may please be seated. At this time, Joe's nieces, Mary Angela and Marilyn, will go to the back of the church and will be bringing up the bread and wine.
Please join in the gather. The Gray Book, number 701, 701.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. lift your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord and our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, in Him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended.
be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days. And by the help of your mercy, may you always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not in our sins, on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, to live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of
peace. Peace.
Please join in the gather, number 754, number 754.
Thank you.
Dominus tecum. Benedicta tu in mulieribus, et benedictus, fructus ventris, tu.
Hello, everyone. So I'm just here to talk about what it was like to be a grandson of Joseph Bertone. Going back to some of my first memories of my Grandpa Joe, it all goes back to when I was at school here in Ashtabula, Ohio, not too far from Jefferson. And I remember I was outside playing at recess, and someone tapped me on the shoulder, and I turned around, and it was my Grandpa Joe. And I was like, "What are you doing here? I'm at school." And that day I learned he was a substitute teacher. Grandpa Joe had a lot of jobs, a lot of trades, a lot of things that he did, and that's something that we can always remember. The theme of, you know, what it was like being a grandson of Grandpa Joe was that he was always there. Moving on to more memories, I don't think there was ever a single birthday that he ever missed. He was always at my birthday. He was always there to share stories and make us laugh. And, you know, he had lots and lots of stories, even if they weren't always the most appropriate ones. But, you know, he was happy to share them. And he was always there. Even when we moved from Ohio to Virginia, he came with us, and he was always willing to help us out. When Bobby and I, we started football, he was more than happy to always drive us to football practice and, you know, give us little tips on, you know, do this, do that, and you'll make the tackle, or, you know, this will make it easier. He was always there. Even in my high school days, you know, I had done ROTC, which was a very demanding sort of program, and I always had to be at school early, and I was always at school late, and he was willing to drive me when I didn't have my license. He never, ever, you know, had anything to say about it. He was always very happy and very willing to, you know, do those extra sorts of things for me, and he loved talking about those sorts of things. When I got my first car, or I was getting ready to purchase my first car, he came with me. We drove an hour and a half to this used car dealership where I wanted to buy this Chevy Malibu that I thought was phenomenal. And he sat there with me through the whole process, and he pulled me aside as I was getting ready to, you know, sign the papers and get the car. He was like, you know, you don't know, but this is a really high interest rate. We're not going to do this. And, you know, he was very wise for that, because I would have gone ahead and just made a purchase that I couldn't afford. But he said, no, we're going to find you something good. And we were able to find something that was a lot more affordable and a lot better for me. But Grandpa was always there. Up until the end, he was able to see my daughter get baptized as Catholic, and that was one of the last things he got to do, and I was very, very grateful that he was able to see that, because I could see the joy in his eyes when he saw her get baptized. And I'm very, very grateful to have you, have had you as a grandfather, Grandpa Joe, and I know that you're moving on to your next stage in existence, and I love you, and I can't wait to see you again someday, so.
There is so much to tell about my dad. I hardly even know where to begin. I hope you read the obituary. It contains a lot of information I'm not going to include here. I will say a few short things that encapsulate it, though. My dad was Italian, and he was proud of it. He was the first in his family to graduate from college. He served as a hospital corpsman in the Navy and was sent to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba during the Korean War. He took care of babies in the nursery, something we heard about repeatedly and a lot recently, given the birth of Audrey, his first great-granddaughter. He worked in Ashtabula County Juvenile Court for 30 years, starting out as a probation officer and eventually becoming court director and magistrate. He served his community and his church in a variety of capacities for many years. Here are some other fun facts about my dad. Back in the 70s and 80s, my dad had a CB radio, and his handle was Mr. Spaghetti. He had tons of tools and could break anything trying to fix it. He was unbelievably messy and sloppy, and he knew it and did not care. He was extremely smart, but sometimes lacked some common sense. He loved to read Louis L'Amour, John Grisham, James Patterson, any Western novel you put in front of him, and sometimes many of them twice. I also love to read, and so do two of my children, and I credit my dad by setting an example for me of losing yourself in a book. When I was very young, I learned a love of reading. I remember as a teenager, he drove me and some of my friends, one of them Carolyn, who just sang, and one of them Anita, sitting here, in the congregation, he drove us to the Richfield Coliseum for numerous concerts, making sure we didn't get in trouble. And he would go and sit at McDonald's or sit in the car and read a book. I just can't believe he did that. He loved to watch TV. He loved particularly to watch Westerns on TV. He loved to talk about politics. He was a staunch Democrat, but could not stand Biden, and really loved to hate on Trump, and in the South, that's very polarizing. He loved to talk about football, particularly with Bobby and Marcus. He loved to play pinochle, loved pizzelles, chocolate, and crossword puzzles. My dad loved to argue about anything. He loved to agitate people and get them going. He said he didn't like cats, but he really did. He was totally sure that I named my daughter Samantha Jo after him, even though Jo is really after the character in the book Little Women, but I just let him believe for all of his life that it was after him. He really loved his mama, and I'm glad that he's with her again. He loved to talk to his sisters on the phone. My Aunt Mary, his sister, died just a year ago, and it made him very sad that he wasn't able to speak to her anymore on the phone. He actually loved to talk to anyone on the phone. He loved to talk to anyone, anywhere, anytime, about anything. He just loved to talk. He loved Neil Diamond, especially the song America, because it reminded him of his parents' journey to America. He loved to listen to music. If you were over at the funeral home and you saw the picture, whatever, display, all of the music that corresponded to those pictures were songs that he listened to over the past 6 months on his Alexa. Speaking of Alexa, he loved Alexa, and he loved to talk to her as if she were a human being. Recently, I heard him saying, "I'm on the phone, be quiet." I said, "Be quiet, stop, I'm on the phone." Finally, he remembered that he had to say Alexa first to give her the command. And I was in the other room and I was dying laughing as I listened to this whole thing transpire. He loved to tell stories, and then he would say, "And that's a true story," at which point you knew that some of it was embellished. He loved to go out to eat. The first Friday of every month, we went out to eat, alternating between an Italian restaurant he liked and a Mexican place he liked. I can tell you there is zero good Italian food in the South. None at all, but he made do with what we had. Even though he sometimes embarrassed me with a lot of the things he said to waitresses that were inappropriate, I am really gonna miss those Friday nights out. During those dinners, he loved to talk about random stuff and ask me random questions. For instance, I might be talking about a colleague, and then he would ask me what the colleague's parents did for a living and where they lived and what country they originally came from. And I would be like, "How in the world would I know that information?" And it would crack me up, and he would say, "Because I thought you would have asked," because that's what my dad would have done. He would have asked that kind of question because he loved to talk to people and he loved to find out about them. He loved to dance the tarantella. All of the cousins will tell you, you aren't really married until you dance the tarantella with Uncle Joe. My dad loved attention, and in fact, when my daughter Samantha got married, he wanted to dance the tarantella with her. Sammy didn't know how to dance the tarantella, so she asked him to teach her. And he said, "Just stand there, I'll dance around you." And she was like, "But Grandpa, I'll look stupid if I just stand there." But she did what he told her to do because she was an obedient granddaughter. And then at one point during that tarantella, he swung her around so fast that he lost his footing, almost fell down. We almost all had a heart attack. We have it on video, and we like to watch it. And it was hilarious. We loved to do that. My dad loved to talk about the military. He particularly loved to spend time with Bobby and often asked Bobby to drive him around so he could tell him his military stories. He also loved to tell Bobby some very off-color stories too and swear while he was telling them because Bobby was a man now and Bobby could handle a little swearing. Bobby found this really hilarious and would come back and tell me, like, "You wouldn't believe this story Grandpa just told me and what he said while he was telling the story." Sometimes Bobby would go out to dinner with my dad and I on those Friday nights, and my dad loved to try whatever beer Bobby was trying just for something fun and new. My dad loved to talk to Marcus about politics. Bernie Sanders and socialism was a favorite topic that they would discuss. After the presidential debates, they would have long talks discussing what each candidate said, evaluating their platforms, and deciding who they each thought won the debate. I know that this year when the debates come up, Marcus is going to miss talking to his grandpa about those debates. He loved his big Italian family. All of the nieces and nephews, he loved you so much. And I'm really grateful you're all here. And he would be so happy you're all here too. He loved my mom. And when he wanted to be affectionate toward her, he called her Patty. And the funny thing was, my mom actually didn't like the name Patty. And he was clueless about that. After she died, he only ever referred to her as Patty. And that's how I knew he loved my mom so much. He loved that his grandchildren had grown into productive adults in society and was very proud of what each one had accomplished. He frequently said, "While Sammy found a good man, and Bobby and Marcus each found good women," something that was very important in his eyes. He was so impressed that Sammy and John were able to manage their money and buy their first house so soon after being married. He loved how competent and adult that they were. He was often impressed with how good of a dad John is and how efficient and organized Sammy is. He loved how energetic Jude and Griffin are, and how they would often run up to him and say stuff and then run away and laugh and giggle. He often said that he could tell that Sammy and John were good parents because Jude and Griffin were happy little boys. When Bobby lived at home, his room was right across the hall from my dad's. My dad loved to hear Bobby on his computer talking to his friends, laughing and yelling out when they were playing a video game. If anything went wrong with my dad's TV or phone, Bobby was the first one he asked to fix it. He also loved Bobby's girlfriend, Carly. He loved how she would just come up to him and take him by the arm and talk to him and hang out with him. At Marcus and Elaine's wedding, Carly escorted my dad around, and he loved having a pretty young girl on his arm. He loved the man that Marcus had become, loved seeing him become a dad, loved that Marcus had married Elaine, because Elaine is also an immigrant from the Philippines. And she reminded him of his parents and their journey to the United States from Italy. He loved how respectful Elaine was to him each and every time, taking his hand, pressing it to her forehead, and bowing before him, showing him the utmost respect. He loved Audrey and thought that she was beautiful and perfect, and he was so proud that she was baptized Catholic. He loved that Bill was a corpsman in the Navy, just like he was. When I was dating Bill, my dad told me that all the other guys I had dated were boys, and I was finally dating a real man. He loved Sammy. He loved Bobby. He loved Marcus. He loved his great-grandchildren. And he loved me. My dad was one of those larger-than-life characters. He had a tell-it-like-it-is personality, viewed the world through a black and white lens, right and wrong, good and bad, made him a really good magistrate. I think in today's world where we give everyone a label, some might have said he was on the spectrum. My dad was very difficult to live with. He was very demanding. My husband and my children can all mimic him calling for me in a very loud way. Eva, Eva, Eva! He asked very personal questions of people, made comments about other people in public that were unbelievably embarrassing. In the days since his passing, many people have commented on what a loving relationship my dad and I had, and I just want to make something really clear. We argued a lot. He and I could go toe-to-toe on a regular basis. God did not break the mold when he made my dad, because then he made me. I am very much my father's daughter, thankfully tempered with a little bit of my mother's gentle kindness. Bill, me, and the kids and their spouses have a group chat. A couple of weeks ago, Marcus posted a meme in the group chat of Chevy Chase in a scene from the TV show Community. And Chevy Chase is saying in this meme, "You go straight to heck," and I'm editing that because we're in church. Marcus put a caption under it that said, "Grandpa to Mom when he doesn't get dinner at Disney World." We all died laughing, and thank goodness we can laugh about that now. The backstory behind this is one that traumatized my children at the happiest place on earth when we were in Disney World. It is forever seared in their brains. Back in 2003, my mom and dad went with Bill, me, and the kids to Disney for a week-long vacation. Bill and I were on a very tight budget back in those days, and I had everything planned out to a T so that we would not overspend. We had had a very long day in Disney and were tired and hungry, and my dad wanted to eat dinner in Disney. I knew that was going to cost us a bajillion dollars, and I had brought us a meal to cook at home for every single night we were in Disney so we wouldn't have to spend money in the park. So I argued for driving back to our condo and making dinner. He argued the opposite. We had a very loud, large fight in the car that ended with him saying, "You go straight to heck, Eva, straight to heck." He didn't say heck. We all laugh about it now, and it has become a running joke in our family. We mimic my dad yelling it at me. However, that typifies the relationship that we had with each other. Arguing a lot. But we also share the same trait that when the argument is over, it's over. We move on, we forget about it, and go back to normal. Even though we made each other mad on a regular basis, we knew we loved each other. I have often pondered on why God took my mom away from me at such a young age. She was 63, I was 36. I still needed my mom. My kids were all still really young. But without my mom's passing, my dad would not have come to live with us. He lived with us for 18 years, which became a master class in patience and getting along with each other. I think God knew it was going to take us both that long to work out our angst with each other. 18 years is also a long time for a son-in-law to live with his father-in-law. My husband is a man among men. Thank you, Bill, for letting my dad live with us. Love you. My dad started living with us in the D.C. area, and he was very independent, went to church, went to the senior center, shopping at Walmart. He drove all over the area, even up here to Ohio many times. As Marcus mentioned, my dad took the kids everywhere. Bill and I were working downtown D.C. and had long drives to and from work. My dad took the kids to school, all of their activities, to their friends' houses, got up in the morning and drove them to early morning seminary. Whatever they needed and we asked of him, he did. I am forever grateful to him for all he did to help us with the kids during that time. We moved to North Carolina, and he was fairly independent. His health was really pretty good up until 2020. Even though his decline wasn't directly related to COVID, COVID definitely played a part. In June of 2020, my dad got sick and really needed to go to the hospital, but was refusing to go. He was my dad. He was the authoritative figure in my life. I was his daughter. I thought he knew what he was doing by saying he was fine and didn't need to go to the hospital. It just so happened that one of the staff from the senior center called me on the day I was trying to get my dad to go to the ER. Since no one was going to the senior center during COVID, she said she was trying to get a hold of my dad to just check on him and see how he was doing, but he wasn't answering the phone. So she called me instead. I actually don't think this was a coincidence that she was prompted to call me. I totally think that it was God sending her to me. I ended up telling her about what was going on and how my dad was refusing to go to the ER, even though it seemed like he might need to go. She gave me the best advice that anyone had ever given me. She told me that I needed to stop thinking of myself as being my dad's daughter, and that I needed to start thinking of myself as his caregiver. As his daughter, I gave in to whatever he thought was best for his health. As his caregiver, I needed to start making decisions on what I thought was best for his health. She gave me the power I needed to start taking care of my dad and change my thought paradigm. I took her advice, and as it turned out, my dad was in renal failure and probably would have died then if he had not been hospitalized. That was the noticeable turn in his health. He lost a lot of weight after that and visibly became older. It was during this time that we decided he no longer had the strength to drive, and we got rid of his vehicle. That was a really hard day for him, for sure. It was during this time that home health care became involved and started coming to our house on a regular basis. His most recent nurse, Lindsay Gunter, was an angel. And without her, my dad would not have been able to stay living in our home. I am grateful to her for her care of my dad and for her support of me as his caregiver. This was also the same time that he stopped being able to go to church in person. Another person I need to thank is Stephen Roman, who brought my dad the sacrament each and every Sunday for the past 4 years. My dad loved those visits. Stephen listened to the same stories over and over again and brought a lot of joy to my dad in those last years. I am forever grateful to you, Stephen, for your Christ-like love of my dad. After almost a year of being at home, the senior center finally reopened. I arranged for a bus to come and pick him up every day, and he ended up absolutely loving riding the bus. He rode all over our county, got to see things he wouldn't have seen if he were still driving, got to talk to a bunch of random people every day, asked them all kinds of personal questions, got to know all of the bus drivers and loved talking to them and heckling them. During the past 4 years, my dad mellowed. Not a lot, but he definitely mellowed. His brain didn't quite function the same way as it used to. He would forget a lot of things. His favorite phrase became, "I could be wrong, it doesn't matter," because he was never quite sure if his memory was correct. While my dad gave of himself to me for so many years, I finally had the opportunity to give of myself to him. I drove him all over the place, but mostly to doctor's appointments. I got over my squeamishness of talking to him about personal things and just became very frank about it, something I think he appreciated. I grew to love and care for my dad in a different way than I ever had before. Taking care of someone definitely changes the depth of your love for them. My dad started saying, "I love you and I miss you," to me all the time. He had always said he loved me, but this was a big increase. About a year ago, he started getting a little wobbly on his feet, and so we encouraged him to start using a cane. He didn't really want to use it and treated it first like it was an accessory rather than a tool. But for the most part, he remained relatively healthy. In December, I noticed a significant decline. I let my kids know that I had a gut feeling that this was his last Christmas with us. I made him Italian wedding soup, his favorite, made him as many pizzelles as he could eat. As I mentioned, my dad never complained about his health. One day in January, we discovered some issues that led us to a cardiologist and several rounds of testing. In February, he started falling a lot. We got him a walker, and he started using it faithfully. After one of those falls, I felt extremely impressed to say everything I needed to say to my dad. I went into his room, and I told him I loved him, and how appreciative I was of everything he had done for me over the course of my life. And of course, I was crying like I am now. And he immediately bellowed in his loud voice, "You stop crying right now. You don't have to cry over it. I know you love me, and I love you too. Now that's stop crying." I left the room. But as I left, I saw him wiping away tears from his eyes too. On Friday, March 8th, we had a follow-up appointment with the cardiologist to go over his test results. The cardiologist said he thought he heard a little bit of lung. They did do an X-ray. On Sunday, March 10th, my granddaughter Audrey was baptized Catholic. During Mass, he stood up and sat down a bajillion times. He'd just been falling a lot, and I was scared to death he was going to fall. I leaned over to Bobby, who was sitting next to him, and I said, "Tell Grandpa he doesn't have to stand up and sit down." But my dad did anyway. When it came time for communion, all of a sudden, I see him rolling his walker out into the aisle, trucking it up to the altar to receive communion so fast, I couldn't even say anything to him. He was up there before I even knew it. Standard line. We took our time getting to the hospital. We ate lunch first, then enjoyed our drive to Pinehurst. It was a... He then launched him into a conversation about his parents and where they came from and how they came over to Ellis Island. It was at that moment that he completely slumped forward and he was gone. It was like the cutting of a thread, instantaneous and sudden. It was shocking how the life force just went out of him. While I am heartbroken and so sad, I am so very glad that he didn't linger and suffer. I prayed for a long time that he would die in his sleep while sitting in his favorite chair in front of his TV. But on that morning, I felt a prompting to pray differently. Before we left for the hospital, I knelt down and prayed that God's will would be done. That if it wasn't the best plan for my dad to die at home in his chair, I asked that God would take him in the best way possible. And God did. I realize now that God gave me a tender mercy. He allowed me to be with my dad at the exact moment of his passing, allowed me to know with certainty that he did not suffer and linger, that God took him home quickly, and I am so very grateful for this knowledge, so grateful for the day that we spent together and how happy and content he was right before his passing. My favorite verse in the Bible is found in Isaiah 54. It brings me great comfort, and it says, quote, "For a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercies will I gather thee. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath mercy on thee." Close quote. My dad knew and loved Jesus Christ. I could hear him almost every night saying his prayers, praying for me and Bill and each one of my kids and grandkids, calling us each by name. He faithfully attended Mass every Sunday in person for his entire life that he was able. And when he was unable to attend in person, he watched it on YouTube each Sunday and sang along with all the songs. Even though we didn't live here in Jefferson anymore, he continued to pay his tithe to this very church because this was his home church where he served for so many years and he loved this parish. I have the same testimony of Jesus Christ that my dad did. I know that his atonement is more than just the forgiveness of our sins. It is also about succoring us in our time of need. And I have felt the Savior's succoring atonement washing over me during this time of grief, and I am so grateful for it. My faith teaches me that families are forever. I know I will see my dad again. I'm sure I will shed many tears of joy when I see him and my mom together, and I am sure he will say, "Stop crying right now." I love you, Dad, until we meet again. And that is a true story.
Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Joe, and we come to our last farewells. There is sadness and parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see Joe again and enjoy his friendship. Although our gathering will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ.
Please join in the song of farewell, number 188 in the gather.
Receive this soul that we sent him to God.
into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Joe in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Joe in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. This time we will begin our procession, and if those who are going to the cemetery, please follow the directions of our funeral director. You know, turn on your headlights, please. Turn on your hazard lights, please. In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest.
Please join in our closing hymn, Let There Be Peace on Earth. Unfortunately, we don't have the music, but that's something that's probably in all of our souls anyway. So please join and let there be peace on earth.
Thank you.
We were a classmate of Eva's.
Yeah, we were best friends.
And Troy.
Yeah. I do know Troy. I remember Troy. It's nice to meet you all. Thank you.
It was so nice.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So I'll see you guys at 11 on Sunday.
That's like tomorrow?
Sunday.
Tomorrow.
Already.